We are a small startup, so let me introduce ourselves. So I'm a founder of Tempesta Technologies. We do custom software development in high-performance network processing and database areas. For example, we made web application firewall mentioned in Gartner Magic Quadrant as a visionary, and we are also contributing to MySQL. The next week, I will be presenting our work in SQL system versioning at the MariaDB conference in New York. So we do custom software development, and we put all the money to Tempesta FW, this open source application delivery controller, and the subject of my today's talk. Basically, I will say about HTTPS in kernel. However, we never considered to develop our own HTTP accelerator or ever move it to kernel space. Basically, we started years ago from developing machine learning model to fight against complex DDoS attacks at application layer. And when we finished the prototype of model, we realized that state-of-the-art web accelerators and load balancer are not suitable to run such kind of logic. Basically, HTTPS is widespread in modern internet. Every device uses HTTPS to browse internet. We have Internet of Things, a lot of social network, Gmail, and so on. Just very widespread protocol, just like CP. However, this complex DDoS attacks application layer DDoS, which is tricky to fight against. The first one is that the first problem is that such kind of DDoS attacks sometimes are asymmetric. It means that attacker spends much less resources than victim. For example, attacker can send you very large request with large post, which you must compress to pass to upstream server. TLS handshake attack also the type of such kind of attack. The next thing is that advanced attacks use a lot of IP addresses, and sometimes traffic from each address is very, very low, so you cannot use rate limiting efficiently. So to fight against such kind of attacks, people usually use some kind of machine learning. And machine learning makes clusterization of all the clients and determine which cluster of clients are botnet. At the end, the logic sometimes generate a set of rules at application layer. For example, this example from Cloudflare talk from Black Hat. If client sends you HTTP host header with port. It's untypical for normal clients, and we can use it as a signature of the attack. So basically, how we would scan ingress traffic for such kind of attacks? Sometimes we use IP tables or BPF. However, the problem with the approach is that the header can be can cross the packet's bound. However, low-level tools like BPF or IP tables can work only in a range of packets. The second thing is that we have to scan all the data, including probably large URI or cookies, because we don't know where exactly we must search the signature. If we have tons of such signatures, then problem becomes more significant. Sometimes we use web accelerators. They are not suitable for the task. I will describe it later. And the good thing, which is actually frequently used, is intrusion detection system, for example, Suricata. Suricata has a brilliant language which can specify complex rules at all network layers, from IP to HTTP. However, there are also problems with IDSs because they are not communication endpoints. Basically, they just monitor the traffic, and this problem with evasions. For example, if an attacker can generate special TCP segments such that suricata and the victim host will see different streams. Since we not an endpoint of TLS, we also need to copy data if we use a set terminator or process HTTP and TCP and SSL twice. Also, it doesn't improve performance of the server, and this is also an issue. Basically, when we say about DDoS mitigation, we say mitigation, not a prevention. It means that when we fight against DDoS attack, usually some traffic still passes to victim host. Depending on how many traffic passes to victim host, we still can issue performance issues, even if we filtered the attack. So we came to requirement of some hybrid of HTTP accelerator and the firewall. So we had to build a solution which is essentially an endpoint of TLS and TCP. It must use very powerful HTTP parser and network processing unit to be able to process plenty of traffic and filtering rules. Very interesting thing is that if you use machine learning to define classes of your clients, you have a little time frame when your machine learning tries to understand which clients are malicious, and during this time, your system experiences overload. So during this time, it's good to for DDoS mitigation system to have very fast web cache, be able to mitigate the overload. And this is what we especially do using web cache. Well, basically, tools which combine web accelerator and the firewall name it application delivery controllers. And Tempesta FW is essentially application delivery controller. So let's consider why web accelerators are not good to fight against DDoS attacks. The first one is that usually they spend more time to block malicious traffic rather than to normally survive it. It's basically due to additional logic introduced by limiting model. The next thing is that if we want to efficiently block DDoS attack, we use some log parsers, for example, fail to ban. However, if we use the tool, we have to write a very large access log, process it, and the things are not so fast as could be. So basically, we need good integration between application layer, web accelerator, and the firewall. Web accelerators are never designed for filtering, and basically, when you the servers are designed in assumptions that of normal cases. For example, if you expect URI lengths, for example, 100 bytes, then typically web accelerator expects exactly such kind of traffic. However, if you're not able to establish a lot of connections, then DDoS attacker can establish a lot of connections against you. If you're not able to quickly establish TLS connections, then attacker will send you a lot of TLS handshakes. If you're unable to process quickly tons of small packets, then DDoS attacker can send you HTTP flood. Oh no, DDoS attack is about corner cases. So robust solution must be must consider the corner cases. Also, I want to mention kernel web servers. However, they became not needed when we got efficient zero copy interfaces and cheap system calls. However, the need of the such kind of solutions if we try to build a system able to fight against HTTP DDoS attacks. The first thing is not only about DDoS, but also about current high-performance HTTP processing, is that we basically do not have a send file or zero copy interface to work on top of TLS connection. If we need to send some resource to client over encrypted connection, then we need to copy data from disk to user space, encrypt it in user space, and copy it back to kernel for transmission. So send file doesn't work. To cope with the problem, there are many industrial research, industrial development. However, TLS handshake is not addressed. And if we need DDoS protection, then we must implement TLS handshake in kernel. This PF profile for web accelerator under simple HTTP flute, we see that basically it's a relatively flat profile, so there is no several points which we can optimize and get really good performance improvement. The first line is HTTP parser. The second is printing log. We also see copies, input-output routiness. And the last line is exactly rate limiting model, which provides us that additional 1 nanosecond in response time. This system call trace. The green white is about access log, and unfortunately, we cannot disable it because we need access log to integrate the web accelerator with a fail to ban or a similar tool. Basically, the system calls are not so cheap. This is about HTTP parsing in probably all modern HTTP servers. Basically, they use very dummy HTTP state machine. So we start from analyzing input character and current state of the machine. We jump to current state. We set the next state, jump to the end of the loop and the switch statement, jump again to go to the next character. And only that we jump to very near place to make the full the actions. As we see that we do a lot of jumps, conditional and unconditional. Typically, we do a lot of instruction cache misses. And basically, in this simple example, we could just move to the next instruction. So this the parser could be much faster. The second thing about HTTP parsers is that typically, web accelerators use libc routiness to process strings. However, HTTP strings are very different. They use very special delimiters. Some delimiters, like CLF, are very complex because we have to process 2-byte delimiter CLF as well as 1-byte delimiter just LF. The second thing is that STK-SMP usually uses to match HTTP header names. However, if we hardcode HTTP header name, we do not need to convert its case, and we can convert a case of only ingress string. STSPN sometimes uses to validate input data, and it's very slow. It can be much faster. Some of HTTP accelerators use fine state machines, which we just seen, and such state machines are ever slower. So we developed much faster HTTP accelerator, HTTP parser. There are links to our blog. The algorithms out of the scope of the presentation. And basically, on strings of 1 kilobyte in length, we can deliver much more performance than traditional HTTP accelerators. Why 1 kilobyte strings? Probably usual for modern URIs or cookies. Sometimes they're pretty large. However, if we think about DDoS, which can put very large strings, that could have sense. The next topic is asynchronous input-output in modern user space HTTP accelerators. For example, if we have several packets coming to network adapters, software queue takes action on the packets and plays them among different sockets. And after that, the user space process is waked up. Process starts to read the data from socket. It must do very complex logic, for example, to process HTTP, service from the cache, and so on. So since web cache also resides in CPU cache, when process tries to read requests from the next socket, the request is typically out of the cache, and we read it from main memory. So we developed HTTPS TCP IP stack. So we continue Linux TCP IP stack by HTTPS protocol. And we, the stack would be considered as an alternative to modern user space TCP IP stacks. Basically, moving TOS into the kernel took us only 1 human month. It was a dirty prototype. However, it's still much simpler to move TOS into the kernel rather than to move your operating system TCP IP stack to user space. And basically, modern Linux kernel has almost all required crypto algorithms for TLS. So we also made a very fast data structure to keep web cache. And I will also discuss two options which are still under development, is quality of service and the domain-specific language for complex filtering rules. This architecture of Tempesta. Firstly, it's a pointer, doesn't work. Okay. First, the packet goes to IP layer, analyzed by filter at net filter layer. Next, it passes to TCP. There's quality of service, which can respond by reducing TCP window. After that, packet goes to HTTP processing. The first step is in flank, it's the limiting model HTTP layer, which can generate a rule for filtering model, or if we are okay with request, we can forward it to upstream by some of load balancing algorithms or service from local cache. The web cache and filtering rules resides in our database. It's basically a very fast in-memory database with some persistency. About quality of service, basically we refer to, from to HP research in early 2000s, and the trigger for quality of service operation is stress conditions. Stress conditions could be too high CPU utilization, not enough memory on localhost, or too longer responses from web servers. The interesting trigger is ratio between requests sent by client and responses sent to client. If client sends us too many requests, which is and do not wait response for each request, it usually means that this attacking host. The response to quality of service trigger is reducing TCP receive window, causing connection or stopping accept the new connections. So HTTPS TCP IP stack is implemented on socket callbacks. It resides in software queue. So we have no receive and accept queue, we have no file descriptors and just docking. The interesting thing about proxy is true socket case. When we have client socket and server socket, we send requests from client socket to server socket and send response for previous requests from server socket to client socket. In this time, we need to acquire socket logs in different order. And we easily can get deadlock. The deadlock is not so serious. We can fix it. However, acquiring logs on different CPUs are not wished. So we developed fast inter-CPU interconnection transport. So we have lock-free ring buffer per CPU. And if we need to send some data from client socket to server socket, then we just put a job to ring buffer on CPU servicing the server socket, and that CPU will take will care about the data. So there's no logs, and the TCP control block and data per CPU. The next thing is that we work with HTTP message in zero copy fashion. So if we have HTTP message in SKB and we need to add current host to X forwarded 4, then we do not want to make a copies. Instead, we patch Linux kernel by custom page allocator for SKB. And we place SKB and its data, the packet data, in the same page or page fragment. So we use SKB fragments. So the first part of the HTTP request is, remains in SKB header. We link the first fragment with the new data inserted into the middle of the packet, and the rest of the packet becomes the second fragment. There are several limits which we provide in HTTP limiting model. We can fight against DDoS with rate limits, with timers to fight against slow HTTP DDoS. There are some web application firewall rules. We do not try to implement real web application firewall inside the kernel. We implement only quick and very easy checks. And we consider to use more advanced WAF in user space. We also have sticky cookie models, which can be used for persistent sessions load balancing and to fight against DDoS bots which are unable to process cookies. And we have a task to implement JavaScript challenge. It's also very easy to implement, and this for our to-do. The next thing which we are going to implement is our domain-specific language for advanced filtering. The main feature of the language is just like Suricata provides. So we'll be able to specify rules on IP layer, on TCP layer, and HTTP layer, and such rules can generate blocking at low level. Performance, you can find a description of performance benchmark at our wiki. We reach 1.8 million requests per second. It's plain HTTP 1.1 request without TLS, and the results can be achieved at very cheap processor with only 4 cores. If we think about what 1.8 million requests per second means, basically it's at least 3 times faster than Nginx can deliver. In our tests, the best tuned Nginx can to take for us only 600,000 requests, and that time we had to switch off access lock And without access lock, we certainly cannot block HTTP DDoS attacks. And the interesting thing is that we, if we compare the results with CSTAR web server, which is implemented on top of user space TCP IP stack using DPDK, then we find that we, on four cores, this second column, we can outperform the project. The second column is just about 1.3 million requests per second. This is not a real performance comparison, but just some numbers to have sense about performance. And the good thing about Tempesta FW is that as in comparison with user space TCP IP stack, we still compatible with Linux infrastructure. So you can use TCP dump, IP tables, traffic control with traffic processed by Tempesta. We try to keep the kernel code small. It's only 50,000 lines of code for now. We implement on recursal logic in kernel and we're going to move the rest of the logic to user space, for example, data compression, machine learning, and so on. So we need fast user kernel to user space transport. This is still to be discussed point, and basically we are going to use something like netlink map approach, so to map pages from kernel to user space. Basically, since we use pages for SKB and additional HTTP message and parsed HTTP message resides in pages, it's easy to map them to user space, analyze them there, and make a response or filtering rules. So, our site is powered by Tempesta FW. There are no failures for last 10 months. The project is in technical preview state and is available in open source at GitHub. This is a link to our blog where some of algorithms like HTTP parser and fast string processing is described. And so, your questions, opinions, feedbacks?
Your question?
Hi, Tom Herbert. So, very interesting. I'm a little amused when we say 30,000 lines of kernel code small, but couple questions. So, in terms of the TLS handshake, I didn't follow exactly why we had to have that in the kernel. So that should only be occurring at the beginning of a connection, right? Is there a particular reason to offload that also?
Well, basically, we want to make the HPS as fast as possible, just to be able to process as many requests as possible. So it's known that the main performance problem with TLS is crypto algorithm for generating shared secret. However, we still eliminate context switches for initial TLS handshake. Required to pass the packet to user space and pass it back, so.
Well, right, but we have that in like any other application. So once I create the connection, I never have to incur that. So the design of KTLS was keep the complexity of handshake and all of that stuff, put the core data path for TLS in user space. I believe there might be denial of service attacks on the TLS handshake. Is that maybe what you're referring to?
Sorry, I didn't understand the code. Could you please rephrase it?
So TLS requires a handshake. We all agree with that. But in the normal data path, that's not relevant at that point. Mm-hmm. So for the lifetime of the connection, with TLS, if you have a long-lived connection, putting all the complexity down into the kernel just due to the handshake doesn't help. So unless you have an extremely high rate of connection turnover or you're under denial of service attack on new connections, mm-hmm. I'm not seeing that the complexity of pushing that down into the kernel justifies the benefit.
I see. Basically, I agree that actually in one of first slides, I said that there were kernel space accelerators, and we basically do not need additional complexity in the kernel, because basically any user space HTTP accelerator do perfect work in servicing normal requests. However, if we worry about DDoS attacks, application layer DDoS attacks, then we have different situation. There are DDoS attacks which target TLS handshakes. So we must be able to establish new TLS handshakes as quickly as possible. So basically, probably I would say that the main use case for the project is not just a drop-in replacement for common HTTP accelerators, but rather if you consider to use something like proprietary hardware appliance before your Nginx class or something like that, which is able to load balance traffic much faster than usual web accelerators, or block unwished traffic, then this is a good place to use the open source on top of very cheap hardware. So it's not about replacing common servers, but about replacing proprietary hardware solutions. Did I answer your question?
Can I just, okay, Dave, okay. You're the last one.
So one thing I noticed in your slide deck is that you mentioned the issue of packet boundary for parsing, doing detection. Mm-hmm. So the issue is that if you have HTTP headers or TLS headers that span multiple packets, a simple per packet matching system doesn't work.
This one?
No, earlier you were talking about one of the limitations of doing per packet analysis for detecting attacks and things of this nature. Mm-hmm. It's fine, but the main point is that we know that this is a limitation. So if someone wants to, for example, use XDP or eBPF via a traffic classifier or something mm-hmm. like that to do, for example, attack signature detection. It's pretty easy for the attacker to work around those mechanisms. They just have to split their headers into two different TCP packets and segment it this way, and then the detection software only looks at a single packet at a time, right? So we realize that this is a limitation, and Thomas Graf brought this up the other day. We're trying to come up with a mechanism that we could do, for example, have a container that all the packets for a flow go into, and then your parser runs every time a new packet is added, mm-hmm. and you say either, I've completely analyzed this content, I accept it, please move that blob of data forward, or you say, I don't have enough of the headers to completely parse it right now, please continue to collect into this object and call me again when you mm-hmm. have more data. And I think that's a kind of abstract facility that will help a lot of these use cases that have to parse things. For example, one thing we know about the TLS attacks that continually make DNS servers or HTTP servers to do handshakes and crypto operations is that the IoT devices negotiate a subset of the available crypto operations. It is pretty easy to use that as your expression to look for in attack things. Mm-hmm. But the attacker could easily work around that by segmenting the headers into multiple packets mm-hmm. and therefore stateless operations would be very difficult to use to look at that, notice that kind of attack. So, yes, so we realize that this is a limitation and we're trying to remove it.
Yeah, but my point was that if we ever have some state between the packets, that if you probably match the first part of the string in the first packet and wait for the second packet to match the rest, this approach of intrusion detection systems like Suricata and so something like that. So basically you need to consider IDS evasion techniques, for example, when you have fragments, IP fragments overlapping, invalid HTTP sequence numbers and so on. So it's much more robust to be TCP endpoint, fully built TCP stream, and after that...
That was one of Thomas's ideas, is that we have an a socket that we split it onto, and we queue it into the socket with TCP the way that we normally parse all the headers and everything, and then the TCP socket would run the filter on the...
So the filter will run after...
After
on
all that stuff is resolved.
Ah.
Yeah, so that's the idea, just to let you know.
Can we talk offline about this effort? It would be interesting to...
Thomas Graf is working on it. He proposed it as an idea for terminating tproxy mm-hmm. connections and doing protection of nodes using that mm-hmm. kind of scheme. Mm-hmm. So.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I think we don't have time to put in a mm-hmm. penalty box. But okay. Thank you.
Okay, so
appreciate
thank you.
It. Thanks.